Hello and welcome to the Franz van Capre interview. I'm Annette Young. It's probably not the easiest time to be the head of NATO. Its operations are winding down in Afghanistan, and this as questions are beginning to be asked about the possibility of military intervention in Syria as the country teeters on the brink of civil war. Not to mention, European countries are facing an unprecedented debt crisis and slashing their defence budgets as a result. It's perhaps anything but a clear future ahead for the alliance. The man who's shouldering all of this is sitting here with me in the studio at the NATO headquarters in Brussels. I'm talking about, of course, Secretary General Anders Fogh Rasmussen. Secretary General, thank you so much for giving us some of your time.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Firstly, I want to begin by talking to you about Syria. A few days ago, the British Foreign Secretary, William Hague, refused to rule out military intervention. We're hearing reports that Pentagon is drawing up contingency plans. Is NATO doing the same?
No, we have no intention to intervene in Syria. We still think that the right way forward is a peaceful solution based on the Annan plan, and I urge the Syrian leadership to comply with that plan, which has got support from all members of the UN Security Council.
Hypothetically, though, could it be possible for NATO to set up a no-fly zone in Syria, as it did in Libya?
As I said, we have no intention to intervene militarily in Syria. So it's a hypothetical question. There is no call for our intervention from the international community. Even the Syrian opposition is reluctant to call for an international military intervention. I still think that the right forward is a political solution, a peaceful solution. But having said that, we strongly condemn the behavior of the Syrian security forces, and we urge the Syrian leadership to accommodate the legitimate aspirations of the Syrian people.
But increasingly, people are starting to compare the situation in Syria as to what happened in Bosnia during the 1990s, which only sort of ended after NATO launched a series of airstrikes. You must see that there are some similarities there.
Yeah, unfortunately, I think that one of the lessons learned from the experience in the Balkans is what can happen if the international community can't come to an agreement, can't speak with one voice. And I think it sent a very unfortunate signal to the Assad regime when the UN Security Council failed in finding an agreement on a legally binding resolution. But having said that, I appreciate that all members of the UN Security Council support the Annan six-point plan, and I strongly urge the Syrian leadership to comply with that plan.
What are the differences, however, between, say, a country like Libya and what happened there versus Syria?
NATO took responsibility for the operation in Libya because we had a very clear United Nations mandate to protect the civilian population against attacks, and we got strong support from countries in the region. None of these conditions are fulfilled as regards Syria.
If those conditions were fulfilled, is it something that NATO therefore would have to start thinking about getting contingency plans drafted?
Again, it is a hypothetical question, and let me stress once again that we have no intention to intervene in Syria. However, of course, we follow the situation closely because one of our allies, Syria, is a neighbor. Turkey is a neighbor of Syria. And Turkey may be impacted by what is going on in Syria.
As I said earlier, it's not an easy time for NATO. The alliance is winding back its combat troops to be ready to exit the country in 2014. Did the French bringing forward its withdrawal of its combat troops to the end of this year undermine the alliance's commitment to see it through to 2014?
No. And let me first of all stress that such decisions are national decisions, and we fully respect the national right to take decisions as regards deployment and withdrawal of troops. President Hollande announced that decision at the NATO summit in Chicago, but at the same time he announced that France will stay committed to the ISAF operation until the end of 2014 with trainers to contribute to our training mission.
But it must have ruffled some feathers. I mean, it's, you know, while I understand in terms of numbers, proportionately the French troops are small, but symbolically it's a, it is an important gesture.
Actually, we are in the process now of gradually changing the number and the roles of the international troops. That's part of our strategy, to gradually hand over lead responsibility for the security to the Afghans. Actually, the Kapisa province, where French soldiers operate, is among the provinces to be handed over to lead Afghan responsibility in the coming weeks and months. So during that period of transition, as we call it, you will see a reduction in the number of international troops, and you will see a gradual change of the role from combat to support.
But it's still not easy for those combat troops to remain. Only a few days ago, we had the deaths of four French soldiers. I mean, the violence continues, and it obviously is not going to disappear between now and 2014.
First of all, the loss of four French soldiers was a tragedy, and I pass my deep-felt condolences to those who lost their loved ones. I can tell you that the French people can be proud of what their soldiers have done and are doing in Afghanistan. They have contributed to making a clear difference in Afghanistan. You will see such security incidents during the transition period, and this is also a reason why we have decided that while we gradually change the role of our troops from combat to more and more focus on support, we will still be combat ready and help the Afghan security forces when needed.
Now, as European countries are slashing their defence budgets, I know NATO is using the phrase smart defence, saving money by sharing equipment and facilities, for example, but it certainly makes your job tougher, doesn't it?
Clearly, we do have an economic challenge. I call it a challenge because in a crisis, you can also see some opportunities, and the opportunity here is to strengthen multinational cooperation and by that make more efficient use of resources. And that's exactly the essence of what we call smart defense. It's a smarter way of spending money, that we help each other, that we pool and share resources, that we go for multinational solutions instead of purely national solutions. And I'm very pleased that the concept of smart defense was adopted at the NATO summit in Chicago.
But should the alliance continue to fight fires in different parts of the world, or should it, as some say, pull in its horns and solely concentrate on defending its territory?
Let me stress that our core task remains to defend our territory and, of course, first and foremost, our populations. But we have to realize that in today's world, security is also globalized. If we are to protect our populations effectively, we will very often have to go beyond, far beyond our borders to make sure that we are really protected. And an example is Afghanistan. We are in Afghanistan first and foremost to prevent the country from once again becoming a safe haven that terrorists can use as a launching pad for terrorist attacks in Europe and North America.
Now, the reality is that without the United States, NATO really doesn't have the capability to fulfill its responsibilities. Now, as the Europeans are slashing their budgets, Washington is fearing that more and more, both logistically and financially, is going to fall on its shoulders. Is that the case?
First of all, let me stress that it is the essence of being an alliance that we help each other. So actually, it's not breaking news that Europeans need help from America. That's actually why we established NATO more than 60 years ago in 1949.
But they take more than their fair share, don't they, of the burden?
Yeah, and that's, of course, an important point that we have seen during recent years that the Americans have taken on more and more responsibility for the overall security. And we have to get the balance right. We have to make sure that also the European allies take on a fair share of the common burden for our common security. And that's why it was so important that in Chicago, also European allies committed themselves to acquiring a number of essential military capabilities in the future. For instance, during the operation in Libya, where Europeans actually took the lead,
But with enormous backing from Washington.
With enormous backing from Washington. And we saw that the Europeans are lacking some critical capabilities. For instance, air-to-air refueling. And now the Europeans have committed themselves to acquire such capabilities in the future. It's an example that we also learn from the lessons.
Secretary General, thank you so much for giving us some of your time. And that's it for this edition of the Frans van Kath interview. Stay tuned for more news and headlines, which are coming up very shortly.